Sections by John Charles Thomas, Fred Coots, and the Spoliar Singers, and a few words from Dr. Frank Susan, honorary chairman of the first annual Bible Week, which begins tomorrow. Heading the program tonight is Eddie Dowling, master of ceremonies for this half hour of great music, fine singing, and dramatic eloquence. Ladies and gentlemen, Eddie Dowling.
Good evening, everybody. To me, this is a solemn moment, but I'm sure it is to everyone gathered here with me tonight. A solemn moment, and a most stirring one. Starting tomorrow, many Americans of all faiths will attest once more their ancient allegiance to the teachings of the Bible. We here tonight, in this critical hour, have the privilege of starting that national effort, a national effort toward goodwill and true religion. As I look around at John Charles Thomas, at J. Fred Coots, Frank E. Kingdon, and the Schwalier Choir, and all the rest of us gathered here, I know that one feeling overtops all of us in our hearts, as it must be yours at this crucial moment. Down the ages has come the story of man's inhumanity to man, the story we call history. But beside it runs another story, the record of the slow spiritual ascent of man toward the angels, the story we call the Bible. We are glad tonight to pay our little tribute to that story of the long, upward striving of man's spirit. The Bible gave the world the Ten Commandments, that cornerstone of all civilized morality and law. And from the Bible comes that prayer, which rises most naturally to the lips of most. Set to music by Malone. We are privileged tonight to hear it sung by one of America's greatest artists, John Charles Thomas.
Our
newsroom in New York. The government of the Dutch East Indies has just declared war on Japan. The Dutch East Indies are now in the war on Japan. This news was brought to us in New York by the NBC correspondent in Batavia in the Dutch East Indies, Sidney Albright. Keep tuned to the station for further details.
Gathered here to give tribute to the Bible. At such a moment, it would be impossible not to remember that book of books is not only the foundation for our morality and law, but is also the great comforter of mankind. Since the days of Eden, bewildered humanity in its hour of grief has turned to comfort to one of the finest books in the Bible, the Book of Psalms. But the Bible is also mankind's moral compass. Today the world stands assailed by hate and doubt. In this hour, let us here in America refresh our hearts and cleanse our minds with words immortal over the centuries. Words which have been a beacon light for generations, showing to all who care to listen the sharp difference between good and evil.
I have seen the wicked in great power and spreading himself like a green bay tree. Yet he passed away. Lo, he was not. Yea, I sought him, but he could not keep up. Mark the perfect man, and behold the upright, for the end of that man is peace.
Fear not them which kill our body, but which are not able to kill the soul. But rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell.
Six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him. A proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood. A heart that deviseth wicked imagination. Feet that be swift in running to mischief. A false witness that speaketh lies. And he that soweth discord among brethren.
Neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For ye are all one in Christ Jesus. And if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs, according to the promise.
And the Lord said unto Cain, Where is Abel thy brother? And he said, I know not. Am I my brother's keeper? And he said, What hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's blood crieth unto me from the ground.
And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sin. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them, and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away.
Lucy Dowling again. I dare say every person present here tonight and every person listening in has his or her favorite biblical passage. We all know, I think, the story of Ruth and Naomi, of David and Jonathan. Tonight, however, we have chosen as our favorite the story of the Good Samaritan. And now in Hollywood, Walter Pidgeon will read that immortal parable.
And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said unto him, What is written in the law? How readest thou? And he answering said, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy strength, and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. And he said unto him, Thou hast answered right. This do, and thou shalt live. But he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, And who is my neighbor? And Jesus answering said, A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment, and wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest that way, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him, and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion on him, and went to him, and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the morrow, when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host, and said unto him, Take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. Which of these 3, thinkest thou, was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And he said, He that showed mercy on him. Then said Jesus unto him, Go, and do thou likewise.
San Jose, Costa Rica. Costa Rica declared war on Japan tonight, and other Latin American nations are expected to follow. Keep tuned to this station for further developments.
The firmament of his power, for presence of his might, and the greatness of his wonders, for praise him, according to his majesty.
Dowling again. All over America tonight, in thousands of homes, hundreds of thousands, I might say, there are mothers, sisters, and sweethearts who are praying for their boys. No man knows what the future may bring. The event, as George Washington said, is in the hands of God. But four Americans everywhere, out of Harbor, in Fred Sweetie, have written a message of eventual hope, in the form of a new song which will be heard now for the first time by any radio audience. A bugle calling tonight. Bible Week in America, and the Layman's National Committee was sponsoring the week. As I understand it, the committee is a group of laymen of all faiths. Is that so, Doctor?
It's just as simple as that, Eddie. The Layman's National Committee started less than 2 years ago as a small group of 11 men. And 11's not that number, when you remember that that's the number of the apostles who were left after Judas left them. These men, all laymen, believed that the political structure of America was founded upon faith in God. They realized that religion, in whatever faith it might manifest itself, is not a heritage, but a fresh conquest to be won in every generation. First annual Bible Week is the natural outcome of that belief. The Layman's National Committee today embraces all three of America's great faiths: Catholic, Protestant, Jew. Its purpose in Bible Week is to urge each one of us to turn his thoughts once more to the books of the Bible so that we all may renew our faith, each of us according to the light that is given to us. During Bible Week, every American of every creed and faith is invited to join us. Send us a postcard to the Ladies' National Committee at 112 Park Avenue, New York City. We'll send you our brochure called Faith of Our Fathers. Its beautifully colored frontispiece is suitable for framing. We'd like to see it in every American home before another year rolls around. Please remember the address, 112 Park Avenue. Bible Week itself will be just as successful as each one of us makes it in his heart. Men and nations, in the service of which as they lose their lives, they find them. Many dangers beset us as a people. Aware of those abroad, we are very serious tonight. And we are arming ourselves in a program of national defense unprecedented in our history. Yet even while we do so, we are in danger of forgetting the most vital defense of all. Our greatest defense is within ourselves. And our greatest danger is within ourselves. And the symptoms of that danger are bewilderment and hysteria. For if we yield to these, our battle is already three quarters lost. The very emergency confronting us means that now, as never before, we must know what we believe in, what imperatives are to command our actions, what this America really is. Our first defense is in our own hearts. The armies we raise will be worth little more than the shattered battalions of other countries, unless we are all fighting for an ideal that has come to life in us. We don't have to search far to find the source of that ideal by which America has grown to power. We have been peculiarly a people of one book. The men of the Mayflower set it at the center of their colony in 1620. The writers of the Declaration of Independence went to it for their inspiration in 1776. Every speech of Lincoln carried its overtone through the days of our threatened division. And every frontier of our expanding settlement echoed with its majestic phrases. It gave us one language, one idealism, one culture. It has been the one source of our faith and the one deep well of our inspiration. In the making of the American mind, the Bible has predominated over all other books. Today, it stands as the superb answer to the folly and falsehood of Mein Kampf. And so, we do well tonight to pray in the words of a writer who is known to many of us as a columnist, the words of High Phillips, a newspaper man who has found the meaning, the expression of this hour in a prayer. O God, help us to be brave without being boastful, indignant without being intolerant, resolute without being unfair. May we keep constantly in mind thy commandments. And the greatest of these is charity. Charity, in the sense of tolerance and compassion. Keep us strong and yet not truculent. Help us to see the difference between courage and folly, between service and oratory. Make us understand that we are at the crossroads, that this may be the hour of our destiny. We shall need all the elements of our character which easy living has set. O God, give us spiritual strength. Restore our faith, clear our vision. Grant us strength and the sustaining memories of our sturdy forefathers and their honest, God-fearing way of life in peace and in war. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Kingdon. That was most inspiring. This is Eddie Dowling again, calling on everybody in the studio and in the radio audience to sing the battle hymn of the Republic. And I want to thank all you ladies and gentlemen of the radio audience, and I do hope that our message came to you and that it will buck you up spiritually in this hour of great national crisis. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the cast. We shall now sing the battle hymn of the Republic.
Has been presented as a public service by NBC and the independent radio station associated with the Blue Network of the National Broadcasting Company.